evening to discover a string of messages on my telephone, all of which came from Jeff Kipnis, who wanted to be remembered at the conference and wanted to put forward to the conference as a proposition a warning, which was that the analysis of the relation between space and psychoanalysis should be conducted in a modest and cautious way and should at no point pretend to have any exhaustive capacities, and it should avoid falling into any kind of omnipotence and magical thinking. I think the advice is absolutely excellent, but somehow it's some nerve from Jeff warning against omnipotence and magical thinking. Indeed, it occurred to me, to those who study the nature of those class of speech acts called performatives, there really ought to be a new type of performative in which you, as it were, you enact something in the process of forbidding it. So if I say to you, I think it's important that you're not omnipotent, there is, of course, a certain omnipotence that goes with it. It's rather like saying you're not to think about sex, which, of course, produces the opposite effect. So we're warned against omnipotence for the second day. I don't think we actually betrayed it yesterday. We're going to start this morning, and it's a great pleasure to welcome Joan Copjec. Joe, the title of Joan's paper, and perhaps this is the answer to Jeff, it's called Envy and the Symmetry of Everyone's Relation to One Another. Joan is the director of the Center of the Study of Psychoanalysis and Culture at the University of Buffalo, where she teaches in the English Comparative Literature and Media Study departments. She's the author, as many of you will know, of the book Read My Desire, Lacan Against the Historicists, as well as the forthcoming Ethics of the Absolute All. And what the person has forgotten here is the book on film noir. She's edited Jacques Lacan's Télévision and also edited with Michael Sorkin, Giving Ground, The Politics of Propinquity, which was published by Verso last year. It's a great pleasure to welcome Joan Copjec.
I'm going to throw caution to the wind and by not disavowing the subject of the conference. When I was first approached about the conference, I can't read this paper. I responded affirmatively by saying I actually do have a paper on psychoanalysis and urban space. But I didn't always feel this way. When I wrote the first version, it was in response to an external demand to produce a paper for a conference on Jerusalem, organized by Michael Sorkin at the Rockefeller Foundation in Bellagio. Now, I wanted to attend the conference, to which Palestinian and Israeli architects I knew had been invited because I thought it would be an event. So I accepted my assignment reluctantly, thinking I could probably patch something together, one always does, but that I would probably humiliate myself in front of people who were really trying to solve a real problem. But as the conference went on quite dramatically, with people shouting and crying and storming out while the architects presented their schemes for the redesign of Jerusalem, and Moshe Safdie tried to defend his interventions, I began to think my paper was more appropriate than I had thought. Like the two groups from the Winnebago tribe, famously analyzed by Levi Strauss, the Palestinian and Israeli architects had two completely different spatial conceptions of the city. But their design schemes, while produced by the real wound that at the heart of the city, were not touching it. Don't get me wrong. I'm mindful of the warning. I am not suggesting that psychoanalysis is going to be able to provide a design solution to Jerusalem, the problem of Jerusalem. But it is certainly a necessary tool for reformulating the problem itself. If you grant me for the moment the anodyne assumption that film noir is, among other things, a compendium of base human emotions, you will be less surprised by my beginning this discussion of the religious and ethnic tensions that perturb relations in cities such as Jerusalem with a scene from one of the classics of the noir genre. I have in mind the 1944 film Laura, particularly that scene in which the voiceover narrator, Lydecker, discovers that Laura, the woman whom he has calculatedly transformed into his most admiring devotee, has begun spending her evenings with another man. As he peers up from the street at the drawn shade of her second story window, Lydecker catches a glimpse of two silhouettes, not the lonely one he would have preferred to see. From this moment on, he will not rest until he has utterly demolished the career of the man who cast the second silhouette, a painter named Jacobi. Okay, so the first clip, the short one.
I walked for a long time. Then I found myself before her apartment building. The lights were on. It pleased me to know she was home, till I saw she was not alone. But I waited. I wanted to see who he was. It was Jacobi, who had recently painted her portrait. I never liked the man. He was so obviously conscious of looking more like an athlete than an artist. Set up the rest of the night writing.
Cut. The architects particularly liked the building. They were asking questions about who that actor was, and you know, got up a little off the track. The question before us is this: why does Lydecker set himself on this path of destruction, which will lead him to annihilate not only Jacobi, but also Laura, whom he later shoots in the face with a shotgun at close range, or so he thinks? The answer most ready to hand is that he longs for the sort of sexual involvement with Laura that is missing from his relation to her, but which Jacobi apparently enjoys. Nothing, however, could be farther from the truth. That Lydecker feels only disgust for such sexual liaisons is unmistakable, both from his own comportment toward Laura and from his frequent contemptuous remarks about the emptiness and obvious corporeality, the earthiness and obvious corporeality of her other suitors. We must take these expressions of disgust at face value, for Lydecker is definitely not jealous of Jacobi. He is envious of him. The next question is, of course, what's the difference? Crabbe's English synonyms offers this answer. Jealousy fears to lose what it has, while envy is pained at seeing another have that which it wants for itself. Descriptively speaking, this distinction isn't bad. Opposing what it has to what it wants, the definition accurately grasps the fact that jealousy is grounded in the possession of a certain pleasure, while envy stems precisely from a lack of it. Yet one would be wrong to assume that envy's lack can be filled by the possession of that pleasure it is pained to see the other enjoying. As the dictionary entry goes on to say, all endeavors to satisfy an envious man are fruitless. Why? because what he wants and what he perceives as the other's enjoyment are not at all the same thing. And since the envious man does not want for himself what the other has, the attainment of that other altogether foreign pleasure will never appease his desire. It is no coincidence that the two silhouettes on the shade, which are the object of Lydekker's perception, is a cliché. You will miss its meaning, however, if you ascribe the cliché to the film rather than to the character who beholds it. That is to say, it is Lydekker who is responsible for the hackneyed form in which his discovery appears. If this moment of discovery reveals itself to him in a perception that is neither immediate nor fresh, but filtered through a stock image, this is because Lydekker's envious look is not inspired by desire. The pleasure he observes taking place at a distance remains alien to him, turned in on itself. The look with which he beholds this, to him, incomprehensible pleasure has thus a malevolent potency. It is bitter. As has been documented, virtually all languages, ancient and modern, have a term for the evil eye that accompanies envy. The feature that justifies this look's being given a distinctive designation is its apparent intent to poison or pollute. While every other mean and hungry look of hatred in the form of anger, greed, or jealousy remains focused on harm, concentrated on robbing the other of some coveted object, only the evil eye of envy seeks to steal enjoyment itself. In seeking to leave the other bereft of that which brings him pleasure, those other looks nevertheless leave the other's capacity for pleasure intact. Not so envy, which wants nothing so much as to spoil the very capacity for enjoyment. The envious man sickens at the sight of enjoyment. He is easy only in the misery of others. In the famous judgment of Solomon, it is his discernment of the presence of an evil eye that allows the wise leader to unmask the false mother. Having just lost her own precious, irreplaceable child, she is far too bereaved to desire another. What she wants, then, as Solomon well sees, is decidedly not the real mother's little bundle of joy. That this false, foul-smelling, puking little package could be the source of someone else's joy must, in actual fact, seem unfathomable to her. But the extinction of the other's, it's not this puking package that she wants, but the extinction of the other's maternal satisfaction. For this reason, splitting the child in two is not a compromise she is willing to accept, but the sort of ruination for which she longs. It is well acknowledged that pleasure is a private matter, to each his own enjoyment, we say. But the incomprehensibility with which we encounter another's pleasure is not in itself the cause of our hostility. What must be added to the state of affairs for envy to arise is an obstacle preventing the envious person from relishing his own pleasure. Some deficit of pleasure must be felt which spoils the pleasure that remains, makes it distasteful to him. In this way, the deficit can never be made good, never be filled by anything in this world, and the envious person thus begins to regard with malevolence the idiotic passions of others. I have noted that it is the inconsolable loss of her child that initiates the bereaved mother's envy. Turning again to the film, Laura, we find at its heart a loss that is similarly abysmal. According to the ordinary view, the film depicts a struggle between Lydekker, whose contentments are said to be purely intellectual, and Macpherson, one of Jacobi's successors, whose passions are more corporeal. But if the film were merely about a battle between two positive passions, Laura would not have been the direct object of a shotgun blast. It is therefore necessary to suppose that while Lydekker does derive the only pleasure he allows himself from intellectual pursuits, this pleasure is never felt by him to be adequate to fill the loss that deracinates all his endeavors. This supposition is confirmed by the film itself, especially the final sequence. At the outset, I identified Lydecker as the voiceover narrator of the film. A question related to this role hangs suspended throughout the film. From where, from what point in the narrative, does he narrate the story that unfolds? The final sequence reopens the question as preparation, finally, to answering it. In this sequence, the location of the point of enunciation becomes a question with narrative consequences. Okay, a second. This is the final sequence.
And thus, as history has proved, love is eternal. It has been the strongest motivation for human actions throughout centuries. Love is stronger than life. It reaches beyond the dark shadow of death. I close this evening's broadcast with some favorite lines from Dowson. Brief life. They are not long, the weeping and the laughter. Love and desire and hate. I think they have no portion in us after we pass the gate.
Who's tailing Lydecker?
I was going to when he came out.
He left 5 minutes ago.
He didn't come out this way.
Must have gone out the back way. Come on, let's check.
They are not long, the days of wine and roses. Out of a misty dream, our path emerges for a while. Then closes within a dream. That's the way it is, isn't it, Laura?
You have heard the voice of Waldo Lydecker by electrical transcription.
Waldo, you've taken one life. Isn't that enough?
The best part of myself. That's what you are. Do you think I'm going to leave it to the vulgar pawing of a second-rate detective who thinks you're a dame? Do you think I could bear the thought of him holding you in his arms, kissing you, loving you?
Laura! It's Mark. Open the door.
There he is now.
Laura!
We'll find us together, Laura. As we always have been. As we always should be. As we always will be.
Listens to Lydecker's weekly radio address, she assumes he is in the radio studio and that she is thus at least temporarily safe from him. We, the audience, can see, however, what she will soon learn. Through a pre-recording, his voice has been separated from his body. While his voice is being transmitted from the studio, he is in the next room preparing to murder her. This revelation cues our attention to the critical separation of voice and body that will conclude the film. Shot by the police, Lydecker falls to the floor and with his dying breath utters a simple, "Goodbye, Laura." These are his last living words. But they are not the last words of the film. As the camera lingers on a sprung clock, we once again hear his voice, this time off screen, speak the film's final line, "Goodbye, my love." From where do these words come? Not from Lydecker, as he lies dying on the floor. While the final living word clearly issued from the diegetic space of Laura's apartment and from the visibly wounded body of Lydecker, these words emerge from elsewhere. The difference between the two spaces is audible in the lack of room tone in the second goodbye. This suggests that the final line was, like Lydecker's radio address, recorded in a sound studio, not on the film set, and thus not in the diegetic space of the film. In narrative terms, we would locate the place of the Annunciation on the other side of death, somewhere beyond the grave. In other words, the film does not close in the dream that is to us life on earth. I'm recalling the words on the radio address. They are not long, the days of wine and roses. Out of a misty dream, our path emerges for a while, then closes in a dream. But on the far side of it, Laura is no horror film, and it would be unwise to try to make it into one by mistaking the import of its ultimate positioning of Lydecker's voiceover as outside time, outside narrative space, and beyond earthly life. By locating his Annunciation beyond the grave, the film gives us insight not into the ontological character of its world, but into the psychological character of Lydecker. It is he who places himself, or that which is most precious to him, what he most deeply wants, beyond earthly life and all the pleasures it can offer. He speaks and perceives the world as one who is dissatisfied with it, precisely because, by definition, it lacks and therefore cannot give him what he desires. Life for him is as insubstantial as a dream. What he wants is something more profound. What about Laura? Does he want her? The answer is a complex no. She is for him an idealization, which is to say she represents not so much what he wants as its unavailability. She is a stand-in for that which is missing from the world and which he therefore cannot touch. She embodies not a positive good, a particular pleasure, but the distance that separates every good that is in reach from the absent one we long to possess. This is manifest in the very opening lines of the film spoken by Lydecker. "I'll never forget the day Laura died." As the film reveals, however, Laura did not die on the day he so vividly remembers. The significance of his premature mourning is that it betrays his melancholic attitude toward Laura as toward life in general. The melancholic mourns the structurally lost object by allowing it to cast a shadow on the living, which suffers, therefore, an untimely death. Here we touch on the structural truth of envy. It is always closely tied to the idealizations which it both feeds on and creates. For the very stuff from which idealizations are composed is never anything but the hollowness of envy's unhappiness. Earlier, I justified the reference to Laura by commenting that film noir traded in base human emotions. I might have added that it does so as part of a broader speculation on the dark entanglement of urban relations. Noir films are about the city and the myriad ways in which life in them turns toxic. During the historical period of the development of the genre, racial and ethnic tensions were just barely perceptible behind the smog as one of its causes. The hard-boiled detective, the main protagonist of the film, might, for example, be required to venture into a black neighborhood or jazz club, areas generally skirted by whites, in order to track down some lead. But these parts of the town were usually in deep background. In the foreground of the detective's office, the denizens of discounted, unimaginable neighborhoods would stream through one by one, quirky, in some way deformed, but never clearly racialized. It was as if they had been required, by some artistic rule, to doff such telltale traits at the detective's door as a price for entering. That this is exactly what was going on is also the surmise of later films of the period and more recent revivals, and I'm thinking particularly of Kiss Me Deadly and Blade Runner, in which the formerly doff traits are returned to these characters. The gallery of rogues is exposed as a gallery of racial types. But if noir was able to adumbrate envy as the fathomless and bitter source of social rivalries, social and political theorists did not pick up on the clue. They had given no serious consideration to this vice and its injurious contributions to social relations, except John Rawls, of course, whose benchmark book, A Theory of Justice, does indeed pause to examine the place of envy in social life. Because the aim of Rawls's book is to propose, as the title indicates, a theory of the possibility of justice, envy, which stands in justice's way, is set aside as at the beginning. A neo-Kantian, Rawls wants to locate the condition of the possibility of justice in human reason, and thus brackets those motives of self-interest, including envy, which cause reason to swerve away from its proper destiny, which is disinterested and not selfish. But he can avoid the topic of envy only so long, since he cannot pretend to be unaware of a significant challenge to the legitimacy of his assumption that envy is merely an obstacle to justice. According to this challenge, articulated most forcefully by Freud, envy is not simply an impediment, but the very condition of our notion of justice. What Freud argues in group psychology and the analysis of the ego is that the intensity of envy's hostility is so noxious that it threatens to harm even the one who envies, who thus calls for a truce in the form of a demand for justice and equality for all. That is, envy defends itself against its own invidiousness by transforming itself into group feeling. The esprit de corps cementing groups' relations is guaranteed by the following pledge. No one must want to put himself forward, everyone must be the same and have the same. From this, Freud draws the radical conclusion that social justice means that we deny ourselves many things so that others may have to do without them as well, or what is the same thing may not be able to ask for them. This demand for equality is the root of social conscience and the sense of duty. Freud's conclusion blasts at the foundation of the theory of justice Rawls lays out. He must, therefore, deal with it head on. How does he do so? First, he argues that the notion of equality Freud targets is different from the one he proposes, an equality that is bound in the end to make everyone, including the less advantaged, worse off. Maybe one kind of equality, specifically the one implied by strict egalitarianism's insistence that all goods be equally distributed, but it cannot be accepted as a definition of equality as such. Rawls believes he has protected himself from the charge that his theory of justice aspires to equality in Freud's sense because his theory respects the plurality of distinct persons with separate systems of ends. That is, he rejects utilitarianism's false assumption that we all desire the same thing and argues instead that individuals have, and have a right to have, different desires. As we will see presently, however, Rawls does allow one common desire to sneak into his theory and even to assume primary place. The argument begins by focusing, as Freud did, on the emergence of envy among siblings in the nursery. Rawls speculates that Freud may have inaccurately describe what goes on here. Rather than the non-moral feeling of envy, sibling rivalries may actually exemplify legitimate moral resentment about being unfairly denied one due share of parental attention and affection. The siblings may vie with each other not out of a feeling of impotence or a lack of self-confidence, which Rawls cites as the roots of envy, but out of a confident conviction that their claim to their parents' affection are equally valid, that is, out of feelings of fairness and self-worth. By redescribing the nursery scenario in this way, Rawls intends to distinguish Freud's notion of equality from one at stake in his theory of justice, and thus to reclaim the scenario for his own theory. His redescription implies that the siblings do not have the same desire, but instead want their different desires to be recognized by their parents. Rawls thus avoids strict egalitarianism's demand that equal shares of goods, or the good, be distributed to all in favor of a demand for equality of opportunity and recognition. His belief is that this demand is a demand for justice, and that this notion of justice is immune to Freud's accusation that it springs from an illegitimate feeling of envy. But all Rawls has done here is simply inverted Freud's argument. A now legitimate or benign feeling of envy is argued to derive from a now primordial notion of justice. Rawls's first mistake is to assume that Freud's notion of envy implies a desire for the object of another's desire. Yet just as Lydecker is envious without wanting what Laura's other suitors want, so too may siblings in a nursery want different things and be envious still. In fact, in order to be sure we understand what envy is, we should make a little adjustment to the nursery scene, which is the locus classicus of the evil eye. And I'm referring to the beginning of the Confessions by Augustine, where Augustine notes the look of bitterness on one brother's face as he beholds his siblings nursing at his mother's breast. Now you mustn't imagine that the envious brother feels the enviable other is sucking at a source that may run dry, that thus leaving him, the next in line, thirsty. Augustine makes it clear that this source is a richly abundant fountain of milk, and thus able, presumably, to accommodate both. But you will understand the point better if you imagine the envious brother to be a bit older than the nursling, and therefore greedy not for breast milk, but for something more suitable to his age, something cold from the fridge, a Coke perhaps. As he regards his younger brother, he is nevertheless overcome by an envy that eats him up inside. Why? Because no matter how much pleasure he gets from a refreshing glass of cold Coke, he worries that his brother may get more from that trickle of warm milk for which he, the elder, has long ago lost his taste. It's not the object, the milk, he begrudges his brother, it's the satisfaction. That is, in its most compressed form, the point. Envy envies satisfaction. This odd fact is a source of the excess cruelty with which envy is invested. For if one simply envied an object, one could devise strategies, even vicious ones, to steal it away from another. But no strategy can ever be devised to take back the pleasure of which we feel we have been robbed if the source of that pleasure, which is in the possession of the other, is unappealing to us. No strategy but one, destroy the other's ability to take pleasure, to enjoy. This can be done either by annihilating the other, in which case we submit ourselves to a battle whose consequences we cannot be sure of controlling, or by demanding equality, in which case we submit ourselves to the same proscription on enjoyment to which we submit the other. Since the psychoanalytic picture of envy does not depend, as Rawls assumes, on denying the uniqueness of individual pleasure, he cannot claim to have corrected Freud's view by insisting on this uniqueness. He thus fails to provide himself with a new basis for inverting the priority of envy and the demand for equality. That is, Rawls has not slipped under the radar of Freud's corrosive critique. On the contrary, his theory of justice as fairness places itself squarely in the latter's path and betrays its own tainted origins in envy. How so? In his reinterpretation of the nursery example, Rawls contends that the siblings' supposedly envious demands are, in fact, demands for the attention and affection of their parents, to which they justly have an equal claim. In other words, they are bids for recognition from a parental other deemed capable of granting it. But such bids are precisely what Freud's theory of the envious origins of the demand for equality have prepared us to expect. The reversal of hostile feelings of envy into the social feeling of equality and community can only take place, Freud says, through the agency of another who is not a member of the group. The necessary precondition for the formation of a sense of community, this is from Freud, is that its members should be loved in the same way by one person, the leader. He later adds, the demand for equality in a group applies only to its members, not to the leader. What has happened here to make Rawls's scenario conform so closely to Freud's? The notion of a universal desire, which the political philosopher has denied to utilitarians, has resurfaced as a universal desire for recognition from the same parental figure. In his otherwise astute essay, Justice, Envy, and Psychoanalysis, John Forrester charges Rawls simply with refusing to cede Freud's point that a base passion such as envy could be the source of such lofty and rational ideals as equality and justice. This limited charge miscalculates the extent of the damage done by Freud's argument. Rather than gold from ore, as Forrester assumes, the proposal that envy is transformed into a demand for equality extracts vinegar from sour grapes. Instead of simply supplying the demands for equality and justice with an ignominious but still triumphant history, Freud thoroughly discredits them. Any political program structured on their behalf will thus be subject to his reproach. Two questions. First, what is Forrester's error? And second, what is Rawls's? Forrester goes wrong because he fails to question the relation between the superego and ethical action, assuming implicitly that the function of the first is to rally the second. What the superego rallies, rather, is a pinched and nasty moralism, such as is described in Freud's myth of the overthrow of the primal horde by a fraternal society. According to this myth, the repressed murder of the single exception to the fraternal order, the priapic patriarch, returns in the brotherly taboo against the slightest trace of exceptionalism. Differences are thenceforth denounced, abhorred, as is every form of jouissance that cannot be conscripted into the anti-exceptionalist fraternal cause. Again, the rule is everyone must be the same and have the same. This is a superegoic injunction. It must not be confused with an ethical command. Rawls's error is not to see that his image of brothers demanding validation of their unique desires is nothing but a bad faith version of Freud's myth. The desperate fiction of incommensurable desires as submitting themselves to a common measure scarcely disguises its own absurdity. As psychoanalysis teaches, one has to limit the other's knowledge to make room for jouissance, or jouissance flourishes only there where it is not validated by the other. Turning this around, one could say, out of a number of unique desires, it is impossible to construct any big tent, any subsuming whole that would not quash the differences themselves or increase hostility toward them. This is the poisonous pellet in Freud's theory of group formation, to which Lacan draws our attention in various ways, but never so vividly as in his condemnation of the utilitarian project as a silly attempt to cut enough holes in a cloth for a number of people to stick their arms and heads through it. Any social theory that includes a reference to jouissance will find that no single cloth will cover all desires. In the words of Willie Stark in Robert Penn Warren's All the King's Men, every piece of cloth will be as inadequate as a single bed blanket on a double bed and three folks in the bed in a cold night. There ain't ever enough blanket to cover the case. Opposing utilitarianism, Rawls raises what he takes to be a fatal objection to it. But Mr. Bentham, Rawls never actually says this, but Mr. Bentham, my good is not the same as another's, and your principle of the greatest good for the greatest number comes up against the demands of my egoism. I want what I want, but my egoism is quite content with a certain altruism. I'm also happy to allow the other what he wants. The problem with this bad faith version of the egoistic demand for equality is that it always runs afoul of the other, who is always suspected of not being as altruistic as the one who formulates the demand. That is, the problem always stems from our uncertainty about the other, and thus our fear that he will not allow me my desire. In raising his objection, Rawls does not avoid utilitarianism. He articulates a more clever version of it. Ignorant of the structure of pleasure, believing naively that complete satisfaction is attainable by anyone who, unimpeded by bad fortune, sets about realizing a rational plan, Rawls is not well positioned to recognize the need to swallow Freud's poisonous pellet. As a Kantian, however, Rawls does admit that pleasure is crucial to ethics. Though his image of siblings seeking affectionate recognition of their differences is disqualified under Freud's concepts, we may therefore want to know how it fares under Kant's. Now, despite his reputation as a cold rationalist, Kant well knew that a purely abstract moral law had no chance of receiving a hearing from an embodied subject. This is why he wrote the Third Critique, to heal the gap that had erupted between reason, as he had so far theorized it, and pleasure, to show the indispensable role aesthetic pleasure specifically played in the practical use of reason, that is, in an ethical or free act. The difficulty is in understanding just what this role is. What does it mean to say, as he does, that aesthetic pleasure is prompted by beholding a beautiful object, which object symbolizes our morality? The first answer to come to mind is that the beautiful object represents the goal the ethical act strives to attain. This teleological answer is, of course, in Kant's terms, wrong. For if an ethical act is free, it cannot be guided by anything but itself. It cannot then be guided by an external goal, since this goal would thus become the basis of morality, that on behalf of which the act is undertaken. Such an act would not be free, but would be bound by the idealized vision it served to realize. External to will, an independent goal cannot claim any basis in moral law. Nothing guarantees, therefore, that the goal is freely chosen and is not concocted out of self-interest. It is this anti-teleological argument that is at the root of the postmodern condemnation of master strategies masquerading as benevolent, which would solve urban problems by imposing just and proportionate schemes over vast territories in order to create ideal cities. Once this visionary answer to the question of the role of the beautiful is rejected, An alternative is ready to step forward. According to this answer, the beautiful object does not represent a goal to be sought, but is rather that which incites us to abandon our selfish goals. An example of this argument can be found in the recently published and beautifully written On Beauty and Being Just by Elaine Scarry. Elaine Scarry is most famous for her book, The Body in Pain. Beauty, she maintains, is always a call for distribution. It exerts on us a pressure to surrender our imaginary position at the center of the world and to extend our regard laterally to others. Beauty gives us an opiated sense of adjacency and thus prepares our sense of justice. Beautiful things, she opines, act, and this is, you can see the quality of her writing. Beauty acts like small tears in the surface of the world that pull us through to some vaster space, so that when we land, we find we are standing in a different relation to the world. Concurring with the belief that it is fraternity that underwrites liberal theories of justice, of equality, she embraces what she refers to as Rawls's widely accepted definition of fairness as the symmetry of everyone's relation to each other. Similar in many respects to the first definition of the role of beauty, this one is nevertheless, as I stated above, distinct. While the first presented the beautiful as a goal to be achieved, the second presents it as a salutary fiction that boosts the spirit of ethical will and persuades us to believe in the possibility of justice and the reality of the moral law. Before accepting Rawls's revamped nursery scenario as just such a compelling fiction, one must note that it stands condemned on the same grounds as the first. That is, it attempts to motivate will by an idea external to it. But if both definitions have a certain staying power, even among those who attempt to think in the Kantian mode, this is because each answers to some fundamental argument of Kant's theory. The first attaches to an understandable reluctance to surrender the notion of purpose altogether. For, as Kant insists, in the absence of all reference to an end, no determination of the will can take place. How the question, what is to result from this right conduct of ours, is to be answered, cannot possibly be a matter of indifference to reason. A will that envisions to itself no definite goal is incapable of achieving satisfaction. This is what Kant says. The second definition of the role of beauty, on the other hand, thrives on his insistence that the pleasure one takes in beauty depends on a sense of harmony, of fitness and balance that is occasioned by beholding the beautiful object. These attributes describe, Kant argues, not the object itself so much as the faculties of the beholder, which are on this occasion in accord. Scarry's argument revolves around this sense of balance symmetry, which she takes as the essential attribute of beauty. And she finds confirmation of this view in, for example, Aristotle's depiction of justice as a perfect cube, equidistant in all its parts, in the spectacle of trireme ships, which she claims nourished Athenian democracy, in public parades where a plurality of classes and genders move in concert and on equal footing. But if all these beautiful things function not as ends to be achieved, images of ideal societies to be realized, neither do they serve as mere aesthetic analogies for political fairness. One is heartened to observe Scarry begin to take her distance from others who argue from analogy, who see in the symmetry of beautiful things a mere formal similarity to the symmetry of just relations. Her bolder claim is that aesthetic symmetry encourages and helps to bring about the symmetry of just relations. Insofar as it conceives the beautiful image as active, this position is clearly superior, but it is still inadequate. Not only does it imagine the image to act on the will rather than in it, it does not eliminate the core of the problem, which is precisely analogy, or more broadly speaking, mimesis. If a free ethical act cannot be motivated by an idea or image that arises separately rather than from itself, even less can it be said to mimic a separate image, to produce an analog of an already existing thing, rather than to create something from nothing. And this is to say nothing of the fact that the privileging of balance and symmetry betrays a disappointingly conservative notion of the aesthetic object. And yet, who would deny that Scarry's moving theory does appear to offer a convincing interpretation of Kant's position, especially as it is summarized in his succinct formulation, beauty symbolizes our morality. It's that symbolizes which has got everybody stumped, or did until Freud came along to distinguish a pure signifier, not his word, he says, Vorstellung Repräsentanz, that did not represent anything and was therefore unlike other signifiers. The Vorstellung Repräsentanz, which is the representative of the drive, the only form in which the drive appears to us, holds representation itself in place. It is, as it were, the strut, the support of representation. Now, if beauty could be shown to concern this pure signifier, this the problem we posed, a free will's mimetic relation to it, would disappear, for beauty would not represent anything. If not a representation, what then is beauty? In the vocabulary of Lacan, beauty would be a semblant, an apparent nothing, or that which makes nothing appear. But why would nothing incite an autonomous or ethical will to action? Kant has often been accused of formulating an issueless desire, notion of desire, a notion of hopeless will, of a hopeless will about which we cannot even be certain that it has ever succeeded in acting freely. In truth, Kant was himself sensitive to this problem. A practical use of reason has still to be reasonable. That is, it has to have some cause to believe in the chances of its own success, despite the fact that moral disinterested acts seem, as a rule, less likely to be rewarded than conniving or calculated ones. With the retraction of any guarantee of heavenly reward and the increasing market and social valoration of cunning, ethical will stood, at the time Kant wrote, in sore need of motivation. What reason has practical reason to believe it has any place in the modern world, that this world itself does not conspire against it? Kant's answer is that along with moral will, there arises spontaneously a moral image of the world. That is, an image of the world that is not indifferent or opposed to acts that are ethically motivated. This moral image is not to be confused with a belief in the essence of God, in the existence of God. It is rather an image of the world in which moral will is a genuine part, not a world against which the autonomous subject stands ready to do battle with it, but in which the subject occupies a place that can only be described as supernumerary, since it does not fit into the purely natural scheme of things. If the subject is able to envision for itself this admittedly supernumerary place in the world, this is because she locates in the world an empty place, one occupied by precisely nothing. The surplus of the subject requires this deficit of the world, which by its very incompleteness is revealed to be incapable of realizing itself on its own. What we have here in Kant is not a structure of opposition in which subject and world face off against each other, but in, that would be voluntarism, but an envelope or a topological structure in which the subject appears twice, first as subtracted from, and secondly, as added to the world. The role of the beautiful in this structure is to represent the nothing in which will will be able to trace its own reflection. The quality of fitness which Kant emphasizes and Scarry makes so much about is to be found in this relation between the subject and its world. Unlike the beautiful symmetrical image of which Scarry writes, the beautiful semblant is not external to will. It is rather that through which will represents and satisfies itself. Will, like the Freudian drive, has no end, no goal other than its own satisfaction. Like the drive, it is zielgehemmt, or goal inhibited, it is defined by its indifference to purposes other than its own. It is autonomous. The beautiful semblant does not then incite will to create symmetries among people or insist on their equality. What's wrong with the rigidly formal definition of justice as fairness is that it ignores, as I have argued with Freud, the concrete reality of pleasure, which not only actively resists symmetricization, but turns lethal under its constraint. This is not to imply that ethics comes down either to fencing pleasure in so it won't wander into the neighbor's space, or liberating pleasure so that it can roam where it will. Such spatio-economic proposals for the ethical partitioning of pleasure are based in a still too naturalistic conception of pleasure. It has often been remarked that liberal theories of ethics seek merely to provide equality of circumstances and opportunity, and thus reduce ethics to guarantee everyone's the basics of bare life. Rawls is acutely aware of the limitation of this project and attempts to go beyond it by advocating the recognition of individual pleasure. But once pleasure is denaturalized and shown to be constituted by a detour through the field of the other, equitable distribution is no longer the problem, as Rawls still assumes, like Bentham before and Scarry after him. Deprivation is, so it's not distribution, it's deprivation. That is, the problem is no longer to ensure that everyone has the pleasure she wants, but that she wants it in the first place. Arising in the field of the other, pleasure arises in relation to our uncertain relation to that other. What am I to the other? Since the surest way of guaranteeing that the other recognizes our desire is to make our desires his, we end up depriving ourselves of our own pleasure, choosing instead to invest it in someone else's lost cause. What we find most difficult is hanging on to and enjoying the pleasure we have. If the psychoanalytic critique of equality forbids a single Jerusalem solution, so too does it forbid talk of a shared Jerusalem, which would partition its people and their past fairly through a beautiful symmetrical scheme. There is no whole, no all of Jerusalem to be shared, because there is no big other to recognize and bestow affection on all its citizens. This is to say there is no external norm that can be imposed on the territory. For this reason, equality as a program has to be scrapped. At the end of philosophy and politics, however, Alain Badiou makes a curious distinction which might interest us between a program of equality and an axiom of equality. The latter, he says, disengages equality from the kinds of economist connotations we found in Rawls and restores it to its subjective trenchance. This distinction, I claim, can only make sense through the argument I have introduced here. If a program of equality implicitly depends on the belief that recognition comes and must therefore be sought from the other, the axiom of equality places the instance of recognition within the subject herself. Moreover, this axiom conceives recognition not as an act of pure cognition, but as a seizing of pleasure. To recognize oneself through the other, not through the other, but in the semblant, accomplishes two tasks. It relocates pleasure in the subject rather than in the other, and it leads us to embrace an egalitarian anonymity. This is Badu's phrase. That is to say, an identity that is featureless precisely because it does not turn toward the outside for validation. Now, I want to echo Marx's impatience with the shibboleth desire by noting that difference, too, is becoming a tiresome cliché. That contemporary discourse's reference to it seldom rises to the level of thought. What needs to be thought, rather, is the notion of the same, which egalitarian anonymity implies. This same, I might add, has no dialectical relationship with difference. It precedes the distinction between sameness and difference. Jerusalem is a city too full of sacred places, too full of the ancestral dead to make living easy. Life is sacrificed to the past and the ancestral others by whose dreams the living judge themselves. If the city is to become livable again, it will have to learn not how to divide itself up, but how to make nothing, emptiness, appear. Jerusalem's fiercest battle is not between religious and ethnic groups, but between the sacred and the semblant. So far, unfortunately, the sacred seems to be winning. And saying that the object A is the social bond rather than the leader. I'm sure that's helped everyone else.
I just wonder if your analysis is leaving out the term avarice. It seems to me that...
If I'm leaving out what?
The term avarice.
Avarice?
Yeah, you've spoken of jealousy and you've spoken of envy, but you didn't mention avarice. Mm-hmm. Now, avarice doesn't envy the other subject's happiness. It just wants the object of that person's possession. Yeah. For instance, you might envy another person's television, knowing that they never actually watched the television. Therefore, it seems to me that demands for equitable distribution in a money society don't actually turn on any kind of envy for the object, for the pattern of their happiness, because money is a universal converter. In other words, it's not like, when your film character is envious, what he wants to possess is another person, which is impossible, really. But the demands for equitable distribution are based really simply on the opportunity to convert money effectively into your own desire.
It may be a universal converter, but it doesn't convert universally. Not everyone, puts their priorities, has financial priorities.
Well, if I've understood you correctly, your analysis of envy as the mistaken motive for a certain particular social hierarchy is somehow to do with the incommensurability
it is the repetitive consumption which is unable to bring the pleasure to bear upon the object, and therefore kind of has to kind of repeat itself. And could I,
Another example of, you know, how to deal with envy in political theory has been Richard Rorty's pragmatist attempt to, you know, because his presupposition is that we can, in a way, identify only with someone who is similar like me, so with kind of my own group. So his question is, what to do then in a situation where you have different groups, like, let's say, Jerusalem would be an example. And he gives this famous example of a market. His idea is, let's say we have a market with different groups, and during the day they all do business calmly because they are interested, you know, in gaining something. And in the evening they retreat calmly into their own bars at whichever end of the market, you know, their group lives. And here again, I think it's a complete mistake to think that you can retreat calmly to your bar without thinking, you know, what is going on in the bar on the other side of the street, without, in a way, trying to deny others the enjoyment that you cannot have, which would be also Lacan's, in a way, reinterpretation of Freud's idea that one has to deny oneself what, you know, you also do not want that others would have, to have social justice. I think that Lacan, in the Ethics of Psychoanalysis, with the problem of jouissance of the neighbor, also said that, in a way, you are trying, you hate in the other what, in a way, you cannot have. But my question, what Parvin said about, you know, the idea of object A replacing the leader is not human rights today a kind of an empty object, you know, which is replacing this unifying point of kind of an exception that would hold together a society?
As long as we take Lafore's kind of reformulation of that as the right to have rights and don't substantialize the rights, and located in the point of enunciation rather than the rights which have been stated, which means to say that there'll always the list is open of rights that we can demand. There aren't.
And I was wondering if I could just ask you to kind of try and push the argument on. I mean, it does seem to me an incredibly kind of innovative and powerful kind of argument that you presented. I mean, one which obviously has, you know, does enormous kind of damage to kind of theories of distribution, kind of as justice, as has been formulated for generation by rules. But it's really to kind of to go on beyond that. I mean, into what you've begun to touch on in terms of the spatial issues, because it seems to me, you know, there's just as great a significance in your argument there. It's really, if the question of the creation of nothing is absolutely crucial for reformulating problems which had arisen about the distribution of kind of goods or money, then I suppose in a kind of spatial terms, especially kind of in the urban context you're referring to, it's really the need to be able to create nowhere. And you know, it that would have, as it were, the sort of that would be the spatial parallel to the question of nothing. And I'm just wondering, you know, like whether you'd like to say a bit about nowhere.
Yeah, well, I was, the anxiety I had during this conference never left me that I was going to have to come up with a scheme myself. the only thing I could, you know, that I can allow myself is the, that is a negative, you know, contribution, which is it is really the sacralization of place. That is the problem there, and it's not, you know, just skirting around those, but until people are willing to stop living in their ancestors' dreams, then it seemed to me there's no hope at all for Jerusalem.
Could I just kind of push you back? I mean, when you talk about the nothing, you know, it's not like out of negative kind of theology. So as it were, the nowhere, you know, has actually to make an embodied kind of appearance. So it's not just that they would have to give up all these things, But it seems to me, you know, that the consequence of your argument, perhaps we don't have time to go any further, but is that that nowhere is a positive, I mean, has to take an embodied positive form.
Yeah,
otherwise, it becomes kind of resubsumed under a kind of dialectical argument.
Yeah, I just don't know what nothing looks like.
Nowhere.
Nowhere. No.
What?
No, utopia would be the symmetry of everyone's relations to everyone else, because utopia is always founded on a distribution of pleasure.
Okay, we have to leave it there. Joan, thank you very much indeed.